Hi everyone, welcome to this lecture on nature and spirit in the Homeric hymn to Demeter, one of my all-time favorite topics. At this point in the course, we're moving out of a more religious studies orientation, all the big world religions that are still prevalent today, nature and spirit within them, into a more historical and philosophical topics-driven approach, and eventually emerging from that by the end of the semester with more contemporary ecological studies. So this week, we'll be covering the goddess Demeter in ancient Greek religion, the first unequivocal goddess of nature itself that we've encountered, as well as some contemporary research, or rather popularization, of the cult of Demeter at Eleusis in Brian Marinesco. And in the next video this week, we'll be looking at the Orphics and the Orphic hymn to Phusis, that is nature, Hecate, and other naturalistic deities, as well as contemporary scholar Pierre Hadot on the Greek notion of Phusis and how it eventually turned into our concept of nature. We don't have a ton of time to go over the whole of Greek myth and religion, which would be a helpful background for this week. I'm teaching classical mythology in the fall for anyone interested, but the few pages on spirit and the order of nature in Greek religion in Nisir can be a helpful introduction here. One of the main bifurcations underlying Greek religion and spirituality is the distinction between the classical Olympian religion, sometimes called by scholars Uranian or sky-based, and the Dionysian or Orphic religion, Dionysus being the god of festivity and a darker god than Apollo, Orpheus being a mythological poet-singer, and the ostensible eponymous founder of the religious movement in ancient Greece known as Orphism. These and other aspects of Greek religion, such as its emphasis on the goddess Demeter and the cult of Eleusis, are more Chthonic, that is, earth-based, than they are Uranian or sky-based. In any case, both disappeared after the rise of Christianity and the temple at Eleusis was shut down in the 5th to 6th century CE. Although we sometimes study the origin of Greek philosophy in the pre-Socratics and the emergence of classical or Athenian metaphysics in Plato and Aristotle, as if they were movements against Greek religion, in fact, Greek religion, as Nasir notes, provided the metaphysical roots of Western philosophy. Plato and even Aristotle continue to utilize the resources of Greek religion and spirituality, both explicitly and implicitly, across their works. The view that Western philosophy and science emerged as a counter-movement to Greek religion is both anachronistic and quintessentially modern. In fact, it was the specificity of Greek religion that gave birth to Western philosophy and science. And although Greek religion mostly died out, its influence continued in a subterranean way for centuries and millennia, not just in our literary or poetic culture, such as in Renaissance humanism or Romanticism, but also in the very constitution of the Christian worldview, most of its major philosophical founders being influenced in one way or another by the Greek philosophical legacy and by Greek religion. This influence is so strong that even in the modern period, rebellion against Christianity and the emergence of a more naturalistic view of the world, both in Western science and in the fringes of Western esotericism and mysticism, are all closely tied to the overall Greek worldview. Now, the Greek words for nature are phusis and cosmos, respectively. Nasir focuses on the latter word in its broadest sense as the world as a whole. Hadot will focus on the word phusis in the next video. This world or cosmos is, for the Greeks, a beautiful, intelligible world order, even, quote, a living creature with soul and intellect, as we hear in Plato. In one of the earliest, but by no means the only Greek cosmology, cosmos emerges from primordial chaos, and earth or Gaia is divine. And so we hear in Hesiod of the three ungenerated primordial deities, chaos, Gaia, and Eros. When we think of the origin of Greek religion and myth, we normally think of Homer, the Iliad, the Odyssey, and maybe also Hesiod, the Theogony, the Works and Days, and if we are particularly well informed, as well Orpheus, whose poems, if he ever existed, do not survive except in mythical or legendary reconstructions. Less well known to those who have not taken a classical mythology class is the very early body of literature known as the Homeric hymns. These were not written by Homer per se and are very, very different than the Homeric epics. Instead of grandiose, sprawling tales about the heroes Achilles or Odysseus, told in episodic fashion, what we get in the Homeric hymns is liturgy. That is a large number of hymns addressed to individual gods, telling the stories of those gods and their first and ongoing interactions with mortals, and most likely sung in ritual contexts as part of tohosion, that is, the sacred religious requirements of reestablishing connection between the mortal and the immortal realms. The Homeric hymns sing to many deities and often contain very specific poetic tropes, eerily reminiscent to those in the Rig Veda, which might indicate that some of the earliest material in the Homeric hymns still encodes poetic memory, which goes back to shared Indo-European roots. This is also why the discussion of Greek notions of nature should begin with the Homeric hymn to Earth, or Gaia. I sing the well-founded Earth, mother of all, eldest of all things. She feeds all creatures that are in the world, all that go upon the goodly land, and all that are in the paths of the sea and all that fly. Hail, mother of the gods, wife of starry heaven, freely bestow upon me for this my song, substance that cheers the heart. In Nasir's reading, archaic Greek religion understands nature preeminently as fate or destiny. And as early as Homer, nature is declared to be Moira, a cosmic and moral decree. Earth or Gaia is primary in what grants Moira fate or destiny. As also in Hesiod, Earth first of all gave being to one equal to herself, to starry heaven, that he might enfold her all around, and that there might be for the blessed gods a seat secure forever. And she brought forth the high mountains wherein the gods delight to inhabit, and she gave birth also to the wide ocean, swelling with rage the sea Pontos. Scholars note here that although an Indo-European sky-based religion, archaic Greek religion has the distinction of being more earth and nature-centered. Sometimes it's said that in Greek cosmology, the earth is at the center. It could equally well be said that it is at the bottom of the cosmos. Nevertheless, the earth itself, Gaia, is what gives birth to the heavens and thus the spirit world. The primacy of nature in ancient Greek thought is indisputable, even as it becomes overlaid by more patriarchal sky, heaven, or spirit-based traditions. On the order in nature, Nasir points to the ancient Greek notion of nomothesia, that is, the allotting of the universe by Moira. For the process of laying down or fixing the nomoi, or law, that pertained to each domain of nature. For what we call the spiritual, the Greeks did not have an equivalent. Pneuma, breath, or the spiritual comes to serve this function in later Greek thought, but the foundational notion for the order in nature is nomos, or law, which also can mean song, and to distribute, nemein. Nasir accounts for changing conceptions of nature in early Greek philosophy, first with the philosopher Anaximander. It was the abandonment of the world by the gods, already described in Antinous' speech in Homer's Odyssey, that prepared the ground for Anaximander's replacing of the gods with a natural cause, or eternal motion, which is, in a sense, closer to the concept of Moira than is the will of the gods, but already removed from the overall worldview or Weltanschauung of traditional Greek religion. The gods continue to exist and are important after the pre-Socratics, both in the circle of the learned and, of course, among the folk. But they very often cease to be world-creative powers and are rather described like mortal humans as determined from nature. Such notions were, of course, already embedded in the earliest cosmologies. As we move from archaic to classical Greek thought, justice replaces fate. Earlier Bronze Age Greek religions, such as in Minoa and Mycenae, seem to have been more Chthonic. But after the Trojan Wars and the Dark Ages, a more Olympian form of Greek religion focused on light, the Apollonian, and the epic, an image of serene gods transcendent in Mount Olympus, became more dominant. The more Chthonic or earth-based cults did not, however, disappear. Rather, Olympian religion and Chthonian cults became increasingly integrated. And so, even in the Greek religion of the classical period, we can always speak of the two elements or competing tendencies within Greek religion, Chthonic and Uranian, the mystical religion of Dionysus and Orpheus, in which the element of time and direct contact with the divine were central, as well as the more transcendent view of Olympian gods, ruling over the fates of mortals from a distance and from out of their more sunlit or immortal essence. In Nasir's reading of the transition from archaic to classical Greek religion and thought, dike, or justice, comes to replace fate or destiny, where dike itself means the course of nature and is similar to the Tao, the Vedic Rita, many other terms used to describe the movement of nature. Nasir notes that the earliest Orphic hymns are lost, but fails to mention we do have later ones, which we'll cover in the next video. well as many fragments of earlier ones. And lastly, Nasir notes that Hermeticism, to a large extent, preserved the Greek worldview in later times, as does elements of Gnosticism. So much for Nasir's brief summary of spirit and the order of nature in archaic and classical Greek religion. Let's turn now to Demeter, one could say the Greek goddess of nature. Approaching the ancient Greek world on these themes, we must note at the outset that the number of rich conceptions of nature and spirit in Greek religion is truly staggering. We're now going to go much deeper than Nasir into Greek religion on spirit and nature. Let's start with the Olympian goddess of nature, Demeter, and her cult at Eleusis. Who is Demeter and where do we first hear of her? In the first instance, she seems to be, in later Greek religion, a remnant of earlier Neolithic goddess worship. Comparative mythologists can trace a lineage dating back to Inanna in Sumer, Ishtar of Phoenicia, or the earlier Aphrodite, and also the Isis of the Egyptians. All these powerful goddesses, who ostensibly date back to the Neolithic, continue to have powerful sanctuaries and cults throughout the first millennium BC and beyond. In fact, archaeological findings at the sanctuary of Demeter at Eleusis reveal that it was in continuous operation since at least 2000 BC. Some of you may already be familiar with the Greek myth of Demeter and Persephone, which comes down to us from the 7th century BCE Homeric hymn. The number of parallels in this text to Plutarch's account of the myth of Iris and Osiris in the 1st century CE are so precise and profound that it is difficult for the Greek mind not to assimilate Isis to Demeter or vice versa on some level. Demeter and Isis both disguise themselves as mortal women, undergo overwhelming grief at the loss of a loved one, Osiris or Persephone, and the path of their wanderings are similar as well. Most incredible in terms of the parallels, both Demeter and Isis take up residence in mortal form as a servant in the house of a great lady or queen, and they both attempt to divinize a child of the house in a sacred fire and are both discovered. These details are pretty precise, so it may be that the two myths influenced each other in an earlier period or a later one. Here you see a marble statue of Demeter from the second half of the 4th century BCE. She is shown seated and heavily draped. Her solemn gaze and matronly clothing are consistent with the Demeter we read about in the Homeric hymn. Now, how is Demeter understood by the ancient Greeks themselves? We've called her the goddess of nature, and for some literate Greeks, especially in later periods, this may not have been too far from the mark. In most worship of her, she's thought more simply as the Earth Mother. For the Romans and the Greeks, most elementally, she was the goddess of agriculture, and the Romans call her Ceres, but also the goddess of the mysteries and of the highest order of religious initiations. She is, of course, an Olympian goddess and thus a sister of Hera and Hestia. She's the middle goddess in the progress of their birth, Hestia being born first, then Demeter, then Hera, and sister as well to Zeus, Poseidon, and Hades. She's prevalent in many myths, but the most famous of her myths concerns the abduction of her daughter, Persephone. This is retold in Apollodorus, in Sicilus, but in the most early form in the Homeric hymn to Demeter. She had several liaisons with other gods, including Poseidon and Zeus. She also occasionally fell in love with a mortal man, such as Iasion, a Samothracian prince, or Carmenor, a Cretan king. And thus she as well has more divine offsprings than just Persephone, including Arion, an immortal horse, who was her child after being raped by Poseidon in the form of a horse, Despoina, a daughter of Demeter and goddess of the Arcadian mysteries, and with a mortal she gave birth to Corybas, who is the leader of the Korybants, or religious initiates at her ceremonies, and also Philomelos, who was the inventor of the wagon and the plowshare, again stressing her agricultural connections. Persephone was born when Zeus, attempting to mate with Demeter in serpent form, himself turned into a serpent, and the two entwined, and this is suggestive of the Chthonic or earth-based aspect of all three gods. As to who composed the Homeric hymn to Demeter, we're not sure, but some suggest it was actually Orpheus. We'll never know the answer to this, but we do know it was a foundational text for the Eleusinian Mysteries. Go back to before 1900 BCE, according to the archaeological analysis by George E. Milonis in Eleusis and the Eleusinian Mysteries. It's one of the most literary, readable, and enjoyable of all the Homeric hymns, and it tells the tale of Persephone's abduction by Hades, Demeter's mournful response, and their eventual reunion. An important thing to note here is that Demeter is the only Olympian goddess to stage a successful rebellion against the will of Zeus. In this guise, a Neolithic goddess of grain, harvest, and matriarchy, indeed sustained some of her previous dominance in the ancient Greek world. The outline of the myth or the story told in the Homeric hymns is as follows. First, Persephone's abduction by Hades, with the witch goddess Hecate and the sun god Helios witnessing this, followed by the period of Demeter's grief, anger, and retaliation. First, she turns into an old mortal woman and comes to Eleusis, the palace of Celeus, initially to the maiden's well, after which she is taken in by Queen Metanira. We hear of her interactions with Iambe or Baubo, which serves to cheer the goddess, at which she breaks her fast. Then we hear about her life in the palace, nursing the young infant Demophon, and how she is discovered and reveals herself. Hostage negotiations begin with the Olympians in earnest, are thwarted in part by Persephone's eating of the pomegranate in the underworld. Near to the end of the hymn, we see a wonderful scene of her ecstatic reunion with Persephone, followed by restoring fertility to the land and establishing her religious mysteries. The hymn itself starts, "I begin to sing of the holy goddess Demeter, of the beautiful hair, about her and her very lovely daughter, Persephone. Hail, goddess, preserve this city and lead my song." Its first scene is the meadow of Persephone's play, presumably in springtime. Alone, away from Demeter of the golden scepter and goodly crops, Persephone was playing with the deep-bosomed daughters of Okeanos and picking flowers along a soft meadow, beautiful roses, crocuses, violets, irises, and hyacinths. And the earth, in accordance with the will of Zeus to please Hades, the host of many, produced as a snare for the fair maiden a wonderful and radiant narcissus. In modern terms, this might be translated as, "Hey, beautiful maiden, don't let yourself get snared by a narcissist." Later in the hymn, we hear about other goddesses who were playing with Persephone at this time, many of whom are not attested or only thinly attested elsewhere. Most importantly, Pallas Athena, the battle rouser, and Artemis, delighting in arrows, are hanging out in the meadow with Persephone and all these other divine maidens and nymphs. This is significant because you'd think that Pallas, the most powerful Greek goddess other than Zeus, who knows the mind of Zeus, would have been capable of protecting Persephone from her abduction by Hades. Was she in cahoots with Zeus? And also, one of Artemis's key roles in Greek religion is the protection of maidens. She seems most definitely to have failed in her job here, again indicating the subordination of both these goddesses to the will of Zeus in Greek religion. The moment of Persephone's abduction is fascinating and has been richly developed in art across its long history into the present day, and it seems to be a favorite myth in New Age communities. I found this funny reenactment of what seems to be a pot grower, notice his barn in the background, trying to abduct what I can only assume is a trimmer in his pot scene. I may be wrong here, but the point is that people really identify with this myth of Hades and Persephone. What does the myth essentially mean on a first pass? Well, Hades is the more unfortunate brother of Zeus, who pulled the shortest lot and thus gave dominion over the underworld as his domain. He's never really portrayed as a bad guy, but rather as a bit unfortunate in not ruling over the seas and the earth like Poseidon, or over the heavenly realm and being king of the earth like Zeus. When it comes to the myth or theme of the sacred marriage in Greek religion, it is significant that the two most sacred marriages of all, that is, of a god and a goddess, are on the one hand the marriage of Zeus and Hera, which is the model to aspire to for ordinary Greek marriages, and on the other that of Hades and Persephone, a more troubling in marriage indeed, since it is a marriage by capture, rape, or abduction. The Greek term gamos or gamoi actually means to seize or capture. Despite Hades being a kind of likable guy in some ways, we shouldn't overlook that his marriage to Persephone is by abduction and presumably rape. Psychologically, for the modern reader, there's a lot to work out here. Hades is often called Pluto, the wealthy one and the ruler of many. By arranging with his brother Zeus an alliance with Persephone, an initial fertility come salvific goddess, Zeus seems to be making up, at least in part, for Hades having drawn the shorter stick. Now in the scene of abduction, Persephone cries out or shouts in hope for rescue, and her queenly mother heard her. And at this, sharp pain seized Demeter's heart, and she tore the headdress about her ambrosial hair with her own dear hands, and threw off the dark covering from both her shoulders, and she rushed in pursuit, just like a bird over land and water. But not one, either of the gods or mortals, wished to tell what had really happened. Not even the bird came to tell her as a messenger of the truth. Demeter, at this point in her narrative arc, is a mature goddess of agriculture and nature. And so her grief is an image of nature's own mourning, sorrow over the loss of Persephone. For 9 days then, the Lady Demeter roamed over the earth, holding burning torches in her hand, and in her grief did not eat any ambrosia or drink sweet nectar, nor did she bathe her body. But when dawn brought on the light of the 10th day, Hecate, a torch in hand, met her and gave her some news, as she exclaimed, "Lady Demeter, bringer of goodly gifts in season, who of the heavenly gods or mortals carried off Persephone and troubled your dear heart? For I heard her voice, but did not see her with my eyes who it was. I am telling you the whole truth quickly. Hecate seems to be the one who actually hears Persephone's cry. Demeter also hearing it, but it seems more telepathically and intuitively, as would a mother. And so Demeter and Hecate go off to see the sun god Helios and get his testimony." I won't go through all the gorgeous poetic details here, but it's significant that only Helios, the sun god, Apollo not yet being identified with this role in archaic thought, both has fully witnessed, willing to inform Demeter what really happened. It's Helios who suggests that Persephone could have done worse for her husband. This does nothing to soothe Demeter's dread and terrible grief. Cheer in the stages of mourning turns to anger with Cronos, the son of Zeus. The goddess isolates or withdraws herself from all gatherings of the gods on Olympus, and for a long time went among the cities and rich fields of human beings, disguising her beautiful form. The archetypal significance here is very important. Demeter doesn't exactly incarnate as a mortal, but disguises herself as a mortal. In fact, as Doso, an old woman, herself a refugee after abduction by Tyrrhenian pirates. Grieving in her heart, she sat near the road by the Maiden Well in the town of Eleusis. There you see a picture of the Maiden Well as it is today, from which people drew their water. Her appearance was that of a very old woman, long past her days for childbearing, and the gifts of garland-loving Aphrodite. She was like the nurses for the children of law-pronouncing kings, or the housekeepers in their echoing halls. And so here we get one of the earliest instances of the mother-maiden-crone archetype, the mother being deprived of her daughter, the maiden, turning into the crone or wise old woman, concealing her stature as a goddess, nevertheless appearing in the form of a noble servant. At the Maiden's Well, she meets with the four daughters, Callidike, Cleisidike, lovely Demo, and Callithoe, who address her, "Who are you, old woman, of those born long ago? Where are you from? Why have you come away from the city and not approached the houses there, in whose shadowy halls dwell women just like you and younger, who would welcome you in word as well as in deed?" Demeter tells them that her name is Doso, that she is of noble birth, but was abducted by pirates, and how she escaped during the mealtime to avoid being sold into slavery. And she offers her services to the house of Celeus. Quote, "I could hold a newborn child in my arms and care for him well, make my master's bed in the recess of his well-built chambers, and teach the women their tasks." The daughters are deeply impressed with Doso and tell her about all the honorable and wise men who live in Eleusis. Interestingly, each family name will become part of the Eleusinian mystery tradition, i.e. the founding priesthood, dating back to Triptolemaeus and Eumolpus. The daughters also suggest that any household would benefit from employing Doso, and they beg her to come to their mother's house, Metanira, who has just given birth to a son after four daughters. When Demeter arrives at the threshold of the house, quote, "her hand reached up to the beams and she filled the doorway with a divine radiance. Then awe and reverence and fear seized Metanira. She sprang up from her couch and bade her guest be seated. But Demeter, the giver of goodly gifts in season, did not wish to sit on the splendid couch, but waited in silence with her beautiful eyes downcast until the servant Iambe, in her wisdom, set out for her a chair, artfully made, and threw a silvery fleece over it. Then Demeter sat down, holding her veil over her face with her hands." Some essential context here. One of the most interesting things about Greek religion is their code of hospitality. Strangers from other cities or foreigners might very well be gods in disguise, and so should be treated hospitably so as not to incur the wrath of a god. Rather than see the old crone Doso as a poor, benighted, or suppliant creature, her very nature or essence shines through at the threshold of Metanira's house. And this is, of course, a sign, something divine or uncanny. Instead of pleading like a suppliant, shelter and protection from the great lady, Metanira, the roles are reversed. Metanira and her servant, Iambe, who are already waiting on Demeter. Now, for a long time, Doso remained seated without a sound, grieving. She did not, by word or action, acknowledge anyone. But without a smile, not touching food or drink, she sat wasted, with longing for her deep-bosomed daughter, until Iambe, in her wisdom, resorted to many jests and jokes, and brought the holy lady around to a smile and laugh and to a happy heart. And Metnera filled a cup with wine as sweet as honey and offered it, but she refused, saying that it was not right for her to drink red wine, but she ordered to mix meal and water and tender mint and give it to her to drink. For starters, Iambe, Metnera's maidservant, jests and jokes with the goddess of nature in the form of Doso, and is alone able to bring her out of the funk. Iambe is also known as Baobo in the Greek sources, and here you see a Greek terracotta figurine, Baobo or Iambe, from Anatolia. What exactly are you looking at in this strange image? Take a good look. Yep, it's a ventriloquizing vagina. It seems part of women's mysteries and magic, of the healing of Demeter's distraught soul, involved joking around with one's ventriloquizing vagina. How funny and cute. Next very significant detail is that Demeter refuses red wine. Why is it not right for Demeter to drink red wine? Is this some kind of acknowledgement that alcohol should not be for the grief-stricken and depressed, where it only makes things worse? Not necessarily, for the drink she proposes in its place is most likely a form of beer, but its fermented character is not mentioned in the hymn, so we can only speculate. The Kukaion, we know from later sources and from the Eleusinian Mysteries, is the drink of Demeter, an essential part of initiation into the great mysteries, where hundreds and perhaps thousands of people drank the Kukaion immediately prior to the visionary revelations of the Hierophant and the most incredible phantasmagoric night of their lives. We'll see later in this lecture how the Kukaion, according to more recent scholarship, is most likely a psychedelic brew, probably a beer with mint and pennyroyal, very probably with other ingredients as well that induce visions. What these ingredients exactly are has been the subject of much scholarly debate. We'll return to this later on. Now, having been taken out of her grief, Metnera hires Doso to nurse her child Demophon. Under Demophon's care, he grew like a god, not nourished on mortal food, but anointed by Demeter with ambrosia, just as though sprung from the gods, and she breathed sweetness upon him as she held him in her bosom. The plot thickens. Here, the goddess of agriculture or nature or the earth, having assumed the form of an old woman, nourishes the only begotten son of a great household and almost turns him into a god. Something highly reminiscent of the Christ motif here, but with all the characters playing different roles, there is no immaculate conception, but rather a logic of substitution. Demeter, grieving over lost Persephone, a maidservant in the house of Metnera, substitutes care for Demophon for her daughter Persephone. Thus, because she is a goddess, chooses Demophon for deification. At night, she would hide him in the might of the fire like a brand, without the knowledge of his dear parents. It was a source of great wonder to them that he grew and flourished before his time, for he was like the gods to look upon. And she would have made him immortal and never to grow old if beautifully robed Metnera in her foolishness had not seen what was happening. As she watched in the night from her fragrant chamber, great was her dismay, and she gave a shriek and struck both her thighs, terrified for her child. "Demophon, my child, this stranger buries you within this blazing fire to my anguish and grievous pain." This is clearly not the right response, and Demeter is infuriated. Having been caught in the act of purifying the child Demophon in the divine fire, she begins to transform into the fullness of her form and utters these immortal words. Imagine here that the goddess of nature is speaking to you yourself. Proclaims, "Mortals are ignorant and stupid." Well, we all know that's true. Why exactly are we so ignorant and stupid? Demeter's first sentence as well explains this, because we cannot foresee the fate both of the good and bad that is in store. In other words, what makes mortals ignorant and stupid is that they misevaluate things, calling this good, that bad, weigh things on faulty weights, never actually see exactly how the good and bad are intertwined in every event that occurs, in every fateful destiny that befalls us. We want the world to be simple and dividable, the right and the wrong, the true and the false, the good and the evil, lucky and the unfortunate. This is not how reality and destiny work at all. Very well, imagine Demeter, the goddess of nature, speaking these immortal words to our contemporary ecological crisis. On the brink of self-annihilation and the destruction of our ecosystems, we still are stupid and ignorant mortals who refuse to take an adequate assessment how the undeniable goods brought about by progress and modern technology are intertwined with the bad, dark sides of modernity and humanity's world dominion. We cannot see the whole, the fate, or the destiny that all our conflicting values have in store for us. So, in our foolish, what do? According to Demeter, a thing that cannot be remedied. In Metanera's case, this was as simple as interrupting Goddess in her communion with the child in the fire. But in our case, it's as enormous as failing to revalue our values, to act in such a way that in fact saves our common home and each other. Demeter's observation about the human condition in this first sentence is succinct, but stunningly correct. If we are to acquire wisdom and intelligence, we must learn to foresee, to think ahead, to lead forth into an understanding of fate, Moira, the apportioning of our lives, which no longer misjudges the way that good and evil are intertwined for us, and thus for the first time to be able to recognize the balance that holds our worlds together. Next, Demeter calls to witness the relentless waters of the River Styx, the oath of the gods, that she would have made this dear child immortal, never to grow old for all his days, and would have granted him imperishable honors. But now, as it is, he will not be able to escape death and the fates. And here she throws off her form of Doso and reveals herself in her full splendor. I am Demeter, esteemed and honored as the greatest benefit and joy to the mortals and immortals. And next gives her command. Now then, let all the people build to me a great temple and an altar with it below the town and its steep wall, on the rising hill above the well Calicoron, that is the well of the beautiful dancers. And I myself shall teach my rites so that performing them with reverence you may propitiate my heart. So let's get this straight. The goddess of nature herself in this hymn has not only revealed herself, established a relationship with mortals in a particular place, Eleusis, promised to oversee in propria persona the mystery initiations performed there, and even to teach herself, thus to receive the satisfaction of healing mortals from their ignorance and stupidity, reconnecting them to the nature that is destiny. Now, of course, if the goddess of nature herself came to your town in disguise and then revealed herself in this way with the promise to found her mysteries there, you would comply. And so do the great men of Eleusis. Demeter's true appearance fully restored, beauty breathed around and about her, and a delicious odor was wafted from her fragrant garments. The radiance from the immortal person of the goddess shone far and wide, and her golden hair flowed down on her shoulders. The sturdy house was filled with her brilliance, as though with a lightning flash. And Celius called the many people to an assembly and bade them build a splendid temple to Demeter of the lovely hair, and an altar on the rising hill. They listened to him as he spoke and immediately complied and did as they were told, and the child flourished by destiny. But all is not yet well in Demeter's world, of course. Persephone continues to be held a captive in the underworld. The humans in Eleusis are devoted to this manifestation of the goddess, and yet at the same time they are suffering the most terrible and devastating year on the fruitful land. Demeter having simply refused to let the earth send up a single sprout, but rather keeping all the seeds covered in the earth. They're so devoted to this goddess, and yet she would have destroyed the entire human race by cruel famine and deprived those who have their homes on Olympus of their glorious prestige from their gifts and sacrifices if Zeus had not noticed and taken thought in his heart. The simple version, Zeus and Hades, if you're going to abduct and hold my daughter hostage, then I will hold hostage the whole of the earth. This is the moment of Demeter's most decisive rebellion against the Olympian world order. The Olympians send Iris as a messenger to dark-robed Demeter at Eleusis, but Demeter's heart is unswayed. Thereupon, each of the immortal gods who exist forever were sent one by one to plead with her. But no one was able to sway her mind and her heart from her anger, and she stubbornly rejected all appeals. Implications for her mysteries here being that all the gods of the Greek pantheon visit and are concerned with the events at Eleusis. Now Demeter maintained that she would never set foot on fragrant Olympus or allow fruit to sprout from the earth until she saw with her own eyes her lovely daughter. And at this, Hermes Psychopompos was sent to fetch Persephone from Hades, who agrees to the visit. And wise Persephone was delighted and jumped up quickly in her joy, but her husband secretly gave her the honey-sweet fruit of the pomegranate to eat. taking thought for himself that she would not remain all her days above with August dark rope Demeter. And so Persephone ascends the same way she descended on Hades's golden chariot towards Eleusis. Neither the sea, nor the streams of rivers, nor the grassy glens, nor mountaintops impeded the onrush of the immortal horses as they cut through the deep air above them in their course. This is the scene of Persephone's ascent. One of the most touching scenes in all the Homeric hymn is the reunion of mother and daughter. At the sight of her daughter, Demeter rushed out like a maenad, that is, a wild, ecstatic female devotee in the troop of the god Dionysus, down a mountain thick with wood. When Persephone, on the other side, saw the beautiful eyes of her mother, she leapt down from the chariot with its horses and ran, throwing her arms around her neck in an embrace. And at this point, Demeter is afraid and asks Persephone if she ate any food while in the underworld, to which Persephone replies, "But Hades swiftly put in my mouth the fruit of the pomegranate, a honey-sweet morsel, and compelled me to eat it by force against my will." Seems to be the closest that the Homeric hymn to Demeter gets to a description of actual rape. And of course, the meaning of the pomegranate has been widely theorized. My own sense is that it is a metaphor for the vital essence or soul and psyche of the dead. Small black pit, closed in a blood-like sheath. Sweet and yet bitter, smooth and yet hard, and arrayed in the myriad catacombs of the underworld, each seat an individual psyche. Pomegranate is thus also a pre-image Persephone's eventual satisfaction and maturity in her role as the queen of the dead. Here she tells to Demeter the tale of her abduction in her own words, emphasizing her pain. And in the most touching scene of the entire hymn, the reunion of mother and daughter, they then, in mutual love and tender embraces, greatly cheered each other's heart and soul the whole day long. Their grief was assuaged as they exchanged their joys. Hecate as well is there, her hair brilliantly arrayed, approaching them and frequently embracing the holy daughter of Demeter. And from that time on, regal Hecate became the lady and attendant of Persephone. So there are three goddesses in this reunion scene, as well as an origin myth, Hecate's own becoming a witch goddess associated with the underworld, that is, a liminal figure and protectress of Persephone in the underworld, and guide, along with Hermes Psychopompos, her descents and ascents. Now, having received the hostage back on a visit, so to speak, finally Zeus sends someone qualified to negotiate a peace with Demeter. And this person is, of course, the Titan mother of the Olympian gods, Rhea, of the lovely hair. Surely, if anyone can, it is Rhea who will lead the dark rope Demeter back to the company of the gods. It's only Rhea who's been authorized to make the appropriate kind of deal. The offer is that Persephone will live above ground for 2/3 of the year, and only go back to be with Hades during the coldest winter months. This is a pretty good deal, and in exchange, Demeter must allow the seeds to sprout and break their husks again. Demeter agrees and then goes to the kings of Eleusis, Triptolemaeus, Diocles, Eumolpus, and Celeus, and showed them the performance of her holy rites and taught her mysteries to them all, holy mysteries that one may not by any means violate or question or express. For the great reverence due to the gods restrains one's voice. Indeed, by all accounts and in all her myths after this incident, Persephone lived a pretty good life as a goddess, coming to full appreciation as savior of the souls in the afterlife. She as well goes on during the 2/3 of the year she spends above ground, many extramarital liaisons, most often with Adonis, sometimes also with Hermes or others. The Homeric hymn to Demeter is not merely a myth or a story, also a founding document for the Eleusinian mysteries, and so it ends by singing their praises. Happy is one of the mortals on earth who has seen these things, but those who are uninitiated into the holy rites and have no part never are destined to a similar joy when they are dead in the gloomy realm below. But when the goddess of goddesses had ordained all these things, they made their way to Olympus among the company of the other gods. There they dwell beside Zeus, who delights in the thunder, August and holy goddesses. Greatly happy is one of the mortals on earth whom they dearly love. Straightway they send as a guest to his great house, Plutus, who gives wealth to human beings. Plutus here being distinguished from Hades, though Roman commentators will conflate these two deities. From the Homeric hymn to Demeter alone, we can claim with a surety that nowhere did the Greeks worship nature and natural fertility with such fervency and devotion as at Eleusis. and the Eleusinian Mysteries were in operation for between 1500 and 2500 years, that is, at least as long, if not ostensibly longer, than Christianity. In fact, the sanctuary at Eleusis can be compared to the Vatican of the ancient Hellenic world, and it is perhaps as, if not more important than the sanctuary to Apollo at Delphi. The Eleusinian Mysteries of Demeter have been often compared to the rites of Cybele and Attis cult, the Dionysian and Orphic cults, elements of which are most likely part of Eleusis, as well as to the Egyptian cults of Isis and Osiris. And the initiates at Eleusis included some of the most high-profile people in Hellenic history, famous poets and philosophers like Pindar, Aeschylus, Sophocles, Plato, and Aristotle were all initiates, and all sung the praises of the Eleusinian Mysteries, without, of course, ever giving away their secrets. The tenor of all the testimony we have about what exactly took place at Eleusis, more or less that it was the spiritual experience of a lifetime, most complete experience of spiritual reality that is attainable, that transcends even the inevitability of death. However, we only have concrete evidence about what exactly took place during the night of the greater mysteries because of later Christian authors, some of whom, like Clement of Alexandria, became initiated precisely in order to debunk the mysteries in the name of Christianity. Initiations were called teletai, that is, moments of fulfillment, becoming who you are, achieving the end or the fulfillment of your spiritual quest. And worship during various periods of its history were not restricted to men, but often included women, children, and even slaves. Orpheus is sometimes credited with having originated the mysteries in popular conception. And there are several dimensions of the mysteries, the lesser ones occurring in spring, and this initiate is a mystis, or a blind one, from which we get the English word mystic. One had to perform the lesser mysteries first in order to be admitted into the telesterion, or the great hall of initiation for the greater mysteries, which occurred in fall. These initiates become referred to as epoptes, or viewers of the sacred phenomena. Sometimes scholars question whether there were yet deeper or final stages of initiation as well. And according to some testimony, the population of Eleusis, no more than a few thousand during off-season, would swell to over 20,000 during the month in autumn of Bohodromion, with anywhere from 1,000 to 4,000 people being initiated at once in the great hall, Telesterion. How to ensure that this many people all at once undergo the greatest spiritual experience of their lifetime is certainly a thorny problem in the philological literatures. Here you see a map of the archaeological layout of the sanctuary of Eleusis. As reconstructed by modern scholarship, the Telesterion may have looked something like this. Inside it, there is the Anactoron, that is the sacred hearth fire and chamber in which the Hierophant, priestesses, or other religious officials tended to a sacred fire, much like Demeter's sacred fire in which she purified the infant Demophon, emerging from within the Anactoron in order to conduct the ceremonies. Many of these elements were added by later Roman restorers of the sanctuary. We'll see in a minute how this story developed. When the month of the greater mysteries would occur every year, there was always declared a holy truce, an end to all war, such that for a period of 55 days, Greeks could cease their internecine conflicts, and heralds were sent to issue invitations to all the Hellenic cities. Both Athens and Eleusis were involved in the administration of the festival by classical times. Hiera, or sacred objects, were taken on a ritual procession to the Athenian and Eleusinian and back again. Those undergoing the greater mystery initiations themselves had to go through a number of rituals and ordeals in the 10 days leading up to the mysteries, including ritual speak, purifications, katharmoi, or cleansing in the sea, sacrifices and prayers, various devotions to gods of healing and other gods, sacred processions involving many elements of jest and play, instructions as to the core of the mysteries, austerities or fastings leading to the breaking of the fast with the drinking of the kukaion. If the kukaion were psychedelic or entheogenic in any way, these events leading up to the greater initiations certainly account for the profundity of its effect according to common testimony. We are certain that the drinking of the kukaion was administered by sacred assistants within the telesterion. Also, we hear several testimonies about a dramatic reenactment of the myth of Demeter and Persephone, perhaps including a simulated journey to the underworld involving the sublime terrors and joys of Tartarus and Elysium, and perhaps even a sacred marriage underground. We know also priests revealed various sacred objects which appeared to the participants as bathed in mystic light and by magical utterance transformed. The Hierophant means literally one who shows the sacred things, from the Greek word hiera, sacred things. And we also know the Telesterion included within it the Anaktoron, a small rectangular stone structure with a fire burning within it. The ceremony is thought to have occurred in darkness until the Anaktoron opened up and the chief priest appeared. And at this point, the abduction of Persephone and the wanderings of Demeter are thought to have been reenacted, perhaps involving a rendition of the events narrated in the Homeric hymn. We also know that following the revelation of the great mysteries, there was a great celebration involving dancing all night and a meadow of choral dancers known as the Kalikoron. And then throughout the evening and during the next morning, a procession to the god Iacchus, god of the mystery cry, closely associated with Dionysus and also with the son of the mysteries. Some scholars have questioned whether these relief statues reconstructed from the archaeological remains at Eleusis reflects a magic mushroom of some kind. And there are many revealing depictions of the mysteries of Eleusis in Greek art and sculpture and in the history of Western art. It probably looked nothing at all like this painting. According to Clement, who ironically is our most detailed source on what occurred in Telesterion during the Great Initiations, the heart of the mysteries consisted of the revelation of an ear of grain, and perhaps even a sexual union of the Hierophant and the priestess of Demeter. He excoriates, "The symbols of initiation into these rites, when set before you in a vacant hour, I know will excite your laughter, although on account of the exposure, by no means inclined to laugh. I have eaten out of the drum, I have drunk out of the symbol, I have carried cernos, which might be a vessel containing the poppy," a reference to drugs at Eleusis, Clement makes elsewhere. "I have slipped into the bedroom. Are not these tokens a disgrace? Are not the mysteries an absurdity?" More of Clement's invective. "I have received from the box, and having done it, I put it into the basket, and out of the basket into the chest. Fine sights truly, and becoming a goddess. Mysteries worthy of the night and flame, and the magnanimous and rather silly people that the Greeks are, whom a fate they hope not for awaits after death." Clearly here, a Christian comment. "Oh, unblushing shamelessness! Once on a time night was silent, a veil for the pleasure of temperate men. But now for the initiated, the holy night is a telltale of the rites of licentiousness. The glare of torches reveals vicious indulgences. Quench the flames, O Hierophant. Reverence, O torchbearer, the torches. The light that exposes Iacchus, the mysteries to be honored, are in fact orgies hidden in night and darkness. No greater curses against the mysteries have ever been uttered, nor will ever be uttered, than by Clement. Mysterious figure of Iacchus, god of the mystery cry, joyous triumphal shout, in the twilight morning after the ceremony, may be closely connected to earlier Orphic mysteries of Dionysus Zagreus." And this is a hypothesis supported by Nonus's Dionysica and argued for in Friedrich Kreuzer's massive Symbolique in the 19th century in Germany, and also referred to in Friedrich Schelling's Philosophy of Mythology. The Eleusinian mysteries, according to these testimonies, may be quite Orphic, but we just don't know. According to Milonus, whatever the substance and meaning of the mysteries was, the fact remains that the cult of Eleusis satisfied the most sincere yearnings and deepest longings of the human heart. The initiates returned from their pilgrimage to Eleusis full of joy and happiness, with the fear of death diminished, and stronger hope of a better life in the world of the shadows. Thrice happy are those of mortals who, having seen those rites, depart for Hades, for to them alone it is granted to have true life there. To the rest, all there is evil, quoth Sophocles. And the earlier Greek poet Pindar says much the same. Happy is he who, having seen these rites, goes below the hollow earth, for he knows the end of life, and he knows its God-sent beginning. And this already in the 6th to 5th century BCE. If you're interested in reading further on the mysteries of Eleusis and the goddess Demeter, the two places to start are probably Milonus's book, Eleusis and the Eleusinian Mysteries, and Carl Carreño's book, most to be recommended, Eleusis, Archetypal Image of Mother and Daughter, which gives an in-depth psychological and Jungian account, there informed by philology, of all the aspects of the cult at Eleusis. Before the COVID shutdowns in the summer of 2019, I visited the archaeological site of Eleusis. It was very interesting that the breakfast I found at the restaurant nearby my Airbnb consisted of barley grains in a kind of Greek salad. Eleusis is actually one of the most beautiful and interesting archaeological sites in all of ancient Greece, and well worth a visit. When I arrived, there were actually three or four little girls very near to the maiden's well, as well as stray dogs who make their home in the sanctuary. Here you see some pictures very close to the entrance, and also the maiden's well itself from various angles, and it was interesting to find a little poppy flower growing out from inside. It was the Emperor Marcus Aurelius himself, a major Stoic philosopher who took the Eleusinian mysteries serious enough to restore the sanctuary under his reign. And as you ascend from the lower part of the site upwards, you first pass the Plutonion, thought to be an entryway into the underworld and the place from which Hades ascends to the mysteries. The Telesterion has been almost entirely destroyed, but we can still see some of the step-like rock formations, as well as the site of what is believed to be the Anactoron within the Telesterion. A later Roman emperor also created a garden of the Telesterion off to the side, and still a beautiful tree resides there with many commemorative plaques indicating who was initiated in various years. As you get to the top of the sanctuary, you find the archaeological museum and gift shop at Eleusis, which is wonderful to explore. Just last year, Brian Muranesco made the New York Times bestsellers list with a new book on the role played by psychedelics in the religious mysteries of both the Greeks and the Christians. I was initially skeptical, especially because Muranesco is a self-confessed psychedelic virgin. The writing style and scholarship won me over pretty fast. Materials for this week, I've given us the first four chapters of his book to read, but the most important one for our study of nature and spirit in the Homeric hymn to Demeter is the fourth one, so feel free to skip the first three if you're time pressed. According to Muranesco, the basic experience of initiation at Eleusis is all about peering behind the veil of nature into an eternal spiritual reality. And he provides a variety of new evidence to suggest that the potion or kukion of Demeter was a psychedelic concoction, a hypothesis first proposed and comprehensively argued for in the 70s by Carl Rook. The kukion was a barley-based mixture including water and tender leaves of mint, we know from the Homeric hymn, and this likely means, according to Muranesco, that it was a beer. The psychoactive compounds, iconography concerning the sacred grain or barley, is pervasive in the art at Eleusis. Rook had earlier argued that these crops were subject to a parasitical fungus known as ergot. Ergot can also be poisonous and neurotoxic, and has been linked to bouts of collective insanity when it infects crops in medieval Europe. However, the psychoactive compound in ergot, LSA, a natural version of what Albert Hofmann would synthesize as LSD, is water-soluble from the ergot, so it only takes a little bit of basic chemistry or traditional botanical pharmacological knowledge in order to brew a barley beer that's psychedelic on account of the LSA from the ergot. Mint was likely needed to cut the bitter taste. Here you see kernels of ergot, Claviceps purpurea, sprouting from the flowering spike of cereal grains. We'll never know for certain, but sort of sensationally, Muranesco imagines if we now have the recipe decoded. Just from the three ingredients mentioned in the Homeric hymn, and there may well have been others, like opium, poppy being sacred at Eleusis, and Clement suggesting this connection. Those aside, even in our earliest source, the Homeric hymn, may be that Demeter instructs Metanira and Iambe to make her a drink from ergotized barley, with water to separate the useful alkaloids from the toxic ones and mint to cut the bitter acrid taste known to accompany such alkaloid mixtures. Now by chance, when Muranesco went to Athens, prior to publishing his work, there was an exhibition on Eleusis, the Great Mysteries, that had just taken place. It was a project of cultural revival and tourism, and the flyer read, "It is our hope that this exhibition will be the herald for the celebratory year 2021, when Eleusis will serve as the cultural capital of Europe. Within the captivating sacred silence of that site, we await the humming sound of new initiates." This clearly suggests the Greek government has something in mind for Eleusis in the coming years. This initial exhibition was an EU-funded project, and it underlined four main themes for financing education and arts initiative in Greece. 1. The Demeter Mother Earth program, which focuses on our relationship with food. 2. The Persephone program, focusing on our relationship with urban green areas, gardens, and flowers. We can see how deeply both these programs are rooted in the actual primary source, the Homeric hymn. 3. The Eco-Cultural program, focusing on climate change, energy, and recycling. very helpful response to Demeter's damning observations about the human race, now applied to our contemporary ecological crisis. And 4, finally, the Feminine Nature Program, which focuses on cultural heritage and femininity. In fact, the Homeric hymn to Demeter, on account of the rebellion of Demeter from the patriarchy of Olympus, is one of the most proto-feminist documents we have from ancient Greek religion. And it is one of the only tales that is told almost entirely from the perspective of all female protagonists. Just think of all the female goddesses mentioned across the Homeric hymn, and how much less important the male ones are in the arc of its narrative. Feminists have also critiqued attempts to find a proto-feminism in the Homeric hymn to Demeter, on account of its underlying myth being one of abduction by rape, which is eventually acceded to by Demeter herself and turned into a sacred marriage. However, this should not detract from the more fundamental character of the Homeric hymn to Demeter, as deeply concerned with feminine nature, with the culture of women and women's arts, and with the very nature of femininity and motherhood. The program for this exhibition at Eleusis is very 21st century indeed, comments Marinescu. According to Marinescu, the main lesson of the Homeric hymn to Demeter is that we are a fragile species on a fragile planet, and the ancient Greeks knew this. Death was always lurking just around the next corner, and Eleusis was there to defend them against whatever Greek word you prefer: cataclysm, catastrophe, holocaust, and apocalypse. The Roman world, just prior to its decline and devastation, as well treated Eleusis in this way. Marinescu, scrolling through his phone in the museum foyer, can't help but think of Vettius Agorius Praetextatus, a high-profile aristocrat of the 4th century CE. Prefect, a consul, a hierophant, he held a number of respected political and religious positions in the Roman Empire, and like Cicero and Marcus Aurelius before him, he was initiated into the mysteries. One of those cosmopolitan Romans who felt there was something truly extraordinary about Eleusis. Whatever the sublime vision revealed about the nature of existence, there was more at stake than just personal salvation here. Much more, the very essence of nature, if not also the very essence of spiritual revelation. According to this Roman, without Demeter's revelations, life would be unlivable. Faced with the obliteration of the most sacred mysteries in the midst of the rise of Christianity, declared that short-sighted law would make the life of the Greeks unlivable. Having drunk the glucaion and experienced the vision for himself, the priest points to Eleusis as the one place left that holds the whole human race together. Marinescu comments, the Greek word for unlivable is abiotos, literally the absence or opposite of life, bios, the qualified life of man. It's a rare and evocative word that has fascinated many a Greek scholar, including Carl Kerenyi. Carl Kerenyi concludes that this word unlivable, abiotos, was consciously chosen to inform later generations that the mysteries were connected not only with Athenian and Greek existence, but with human existence in general. The Temple of Demeter was thought to house something indispensable and utterly lacking in the Christian faith. Without that original sacrament inherited from the ancestors, all would be doomed. According to Marinescu, this points precisely to the psychedelic character of the glucaion, plant sacrament that indeed connects nature and spirit under the auspices and directions of the goddess Demeter herself. The ancient Greeks, and who knows, perhaps for some of us today, death and rebirth to nature as spirit is still on offer for the protection of Demeter. If Marinescu is right, then for the Greeks, the secret of secrets, the manufacture of the glucaion, was in part an ancient agricultural and biochemical tradition. The harvesting of the ergot-infected grain and the mixing of the sacrament are believed to represent the origin of all human science, which reveals the mysteries of death and rebirth. And because of the volatile properties of ergot, the production of the magic potion is only possible when the untamed lives in harmony with the domesticated. That trademark balance between yin and yang that the Greeks identified as chaos and cosmos. Their objects to is the fiat of Zeus, back-channel arrangement, lack of transparency with the goddess nature herself. That is, in modern terms, the administrative bureaucracy. She threatens its order with the chaos of nature from within, involving both possible complete destruction of the earth as well as a rediscovery of the healing balance. Indeed, trained by female elders, the priestesses at Eleusis would have overseen the cultivation of the fields at Eleusis. And here the philologist Karl Rook sees that painstaking process as the thin line between wild nomadic ways of a prehistoric era and civilized institutions rooted in the Greeks' biotechnology. The job of the priestesses, Rook contends, would have been to monitor closely the growth of Darnell and Urgot so that neither got out of control. Too much and the deadly weed and fungus can ruin the entire crop, threatening life itself. Too little and there's no active ingredient for the cation. Only when chaos and cosmos work together in the field do the raw psychedelic ingredients of the sacrament result. Lastly, if we can interpret Demeter as nature, we can likewise interpret Persephone as spirit. Under the visionary spell of the cation, Persephone is thought to have revealed the mystery of death and rebirth directly to the initiates. And that's why Demeter set up the mysteries of Eleusis in the first place, so that Persephone could establish a personal spiritual relationship with each of her pilgrims. In the underworld that had invaded Demeter's temple, they would witness Persephone give birth to a holy child, that is, to Iacchus. It's unknown whether Persephone was there in the flesh, perhaps played by a Greek priestess, or wholly envisioned in the mind's eye. Maybe it was some special combination of the two that the Urgot facilitated. The point is, the initiates believed it. They apparently couldn't explain the vision away as wacky hallucination or rattled brain chemistry or wishful thinking. For those who had drunk the cucayon, it was a peek into another freestanding reality. From Demeter as nature, Persephone as spirit is revealed, and once you become a mystic or epoch in these mysteries, there is no unseeing the god. The unanswered questions bequeathed to us by the Eleusinian mysteries are still with us today. How and in what way did Eleusis hold the whole human race together, and how would life become unlivable in the absence of these mysteries? Did the transformational inner journey unleashed by the cucayon remind us how to care for one another and the planet? Was this the true technology on which Western civilization was built? And lastly, is a society that fails to incorporate this mystical experience fundamentally flawed, its institutions emptied of the shared vision that made the world's first democracy actually work? More on answering some of these questions in the next video on the concept of phusis in ancient Greece. And I hope you've enjoyed this general introduction to nature and spirit in the Homeric Hymn to Demeter. See you in the next one.